Hi students, in this lesson of my free beginner course, we are going to learn the third movement of Kuchler Concertino Opus 11. And that's the last movement, so after this lesson, and after practicing it of course, you can play a whole concerto! Yay! That was the goal of our course. But I have an announcement. I will continue this course a little bit and teach you another concerto. And that will be a surprise in a few weeks. If you're thinking, huh, free beginner course, concerto, what are we talking about? Now, this is a free beginner course here on YouTube that takes you from scratch to playing your first concerto and, as I just said, beyond. And if you don't know me, I am Zlata. I'm a professional violinist turned stay-at-home mom. I live in Holland and I share my art and skill online. So, right here, actually. Now, remember that I publish these beginner lessons every week, but don't see them as weekly lessons because that would go way too fast. And I'd rather have you spend a lot of weeks on one movement or one etude and really make some progress, really learn some things, than that you just go through it very quickly and develop all kinds of bad habits and everything is kind of sloppy. Okay, so really give yourself enough time and all the other lessons will stay here, so you don't have to worry, you can come back anytime, right? Now, I don't know how far I will take this beginner course. That all depends how many people like and subscribe, because that lets me know that I'm not just teaching my camera and the wall to play violin, okay? And it also supports my work, of course. And I know that most people who watch my videos aren't subscribed to my channel, so you know what to do before we continue. Now, here is my performance of this third movement with my accompanist Tom Play, about who I'll tell you a bit more in a second. Here is the performance. Thank you. as you probably know, you can download the free sheet music for this whole Kuchler concertino at violinlessonsforfree.com. If you sign up there, I will keep you up to date with all resources that you need to follow along this beginner course. Now, if you want a really effective tool to practice this third movement, then I can recommend the app Tonplay. I use it myself as well as I'm preparing rehearsals with my pianist. And the cool thing about this app is that you can follow along sheet music, you can hear the piano or the violin or both, and yeah, you can just follow it along. You don't even have to turn pages. You can also use a metronome, play it at any speed that you want, make notations in your sheet music. And if you're thinking, yeah, okay, but I've got enough paid subscriptions and apps, well, I've got a free 14-day trial for you if you click on the below link, and then after that, with my special coupon code, you also get a 30% discount. And this is really something that will enhance your practice sessions and get you faster progress on the violin. All right, now let's now hop into a time machine, and the 2016 Zlata is going to give you some pointers on this piece. The thing is, in my performance and also in the 2016 Zlata tutorial, I use spiccato, but for most people, when they are up to playing this concerto, it's way too early to learn a good spiccato. So we're doing that later in this course with other concertos and other pieces. But I would like to encourage you to go to this previous lesson about the bow techniques necessary for this third movement, because that will make it way easier for you to learn. First of all, because it gives you some bow techniques, some ways of bowing for this movement that are applicable to your level at the moment, and then you can play it beautifully anyway. Secondly, by practicing this first, it will fully prepare you, and it will take you a lot less struggle and time to practice this third movement. And know that sometimes a path that seems slower, so to first do exercises on open strings and with scales and stuff, it might seem like a slower route, but eventually you'll learn to play this concerto faster and more beautifully. So I really recommend reviewing that lesson if you haven't done that. Well, now Zlata, stop rambling and give space to 2016 Zlata. Here we are at the third part, the rondo, and the tempo here is quite a bit higher than in the second part. It's something like bam 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 bam, something like that. I have a little preparational exercise for you to do this theme correctly, rhythm-wise, but also bowing-wise. That starts in bar number 5 with an upbeat. It's important that you don't play it like this. Something like that. But really, 1 and 2 and etc. etc. So the rhythm is very important, but also the bowing, and you can see that the first note, so the dotted quarter note, has a line below it or above it, and the eighth note has a dot below or above it. In this piece you have to play the notes with the dots below or above them. You have to play them a little spiccato, so with a jump. Your bow can stay on the string. It shouldn't bounce up like that or something. But it's a good idea to practice this rhythm and this bowing on an open D string. So what you then do, 1 and 2, and the little short note. So you play this long note actually with a very normal bowing. But what you do is that this short note, you play it, you push a little bit with your index finger, and your bow is made to bounce. So, something like that. So practice that first in a good rhythm and with that little bite on that eighth note, so it doesn't become that. It really has to your bow really has to bounce a little by
pushing with your index finger. You see that the bow then bounces a little bit up if you push it. So poing, something like that. but then if you're ready with that exercise, you can add the fingering to it if you've practiced it with the open strings. You can start playing it in the original way, but a little bit slower. So. And then we have this in bar number 10, also with dots above the quarter notes. But quarter notes with dots above or below them are a bit different than eighth notes with dots above and or below them. But you have to play it with an upbeat spiegato. So your bow has to make a kind of U. Something like that. But stay close to the string, otherwise you will get something like that. And that's not the idea of it. So you make a U, and you can practice that if you aren't familiar with it by doing it really slow. So. Something like that. And then you kind of speed it up until you notice that you're not only doing it, but your bow is bouncing along. As well. Let's go through this first sentence, and I'll play it in the original tempo, which is around this. So you see that the eighth notes with the dots are different than the quarter notes with the dots. Mind, of course, the rhythm, so you go from these dotted quarter notes, so from the, and then this is a normal slurred data shaped bowing, so a very normal bow, and then we have a, and then we have a kind of the same, well, we are playing in G major, so normally the second finger on the A string should be low, but in this case it's high, it's a C sharp. We've got the same bowing as in the first sentence. So the second sentence, starting on bar number 13 with an upbeat. And after this, after these two sentences, we have something with very normal bowing. You can do this note, by the way, with an open E string, but don't make it sound too bright. And you really have to count it. One, two, and... So we really have these two short sentences with this rhythm and the bowing, and after that we have a very legato kind of sentence. And the piece becomes very exciting if you make this contrast between this and the... And what you also might notice is that the upbeat before bar number 22 is again a normal eighth note. So so you don't play, but it's just something like that. So there's a slight subtle difference between them. So that's the first part. Now let's continue at the piano in the half of bar 40. And here you see also again eighth notes with dots. The thing is, we're playing pianos, so we're playing quite softly, so you have to give them a little less bite than the eighth notes that we had in the beginning of the piece. So what you do is you make those U's again, but make them really small and subtle, so something like that. But and you might practice that by just letting your bow on the string like this and making little U's. So the bow leaves the string right there. This is slow motion. And then you make it closer to the string. Something like that. And then make it softer and softer. So that's how you practice that. And after that, there are eighth notes, the same eighth notes, but with a slur above them. And that means that you have to play them up, up. So we have. And then you do actually the same thing. It's a little bit similar to what we had before in, for example, bar 17 or 18. So this one. Only these are eighth notes, so it's a little bit with a little bit less bow. So we have from the piano, so we're back to bar number 40. And stay in the spiccato area of your bow. And that is different for each bow. For my bow, it's a little bit here. Most bows, it's slightly more towards the middle, but it's in the lower half of your bow. And you have to find out, also while practicing this one, where your bow bounces the best. And it also helps to tilt your bow slightly to the front. Then it jumps a little bit more controlled most of the time, because it has a soft land on the side of the hair. Well, there's plenty of possibility to practice it. I will play until bar number 48. And here we play not really a double stop, just two open strings. And if you're new to playing open strings, then what you need to do is practice this separately on the open strings, and you need to find a kind of angle of the bow where you have equal sound, so not equal pressure, but equal sound of both strings. And you do that not by looking at them, but you do it by listening. Because if you look at them, it goes like that, and you don't really find it. Well, if you listen to it, then you can hear. You find it. Where they sound both equally loud. And if you've practiced that for a while, then often you can find this in one go. So that's really something you need to practice separately if you haven't done that yet. Well, after that we go to the mezzo forte, so it's a little bit louder. So you can make the bow strokes also a little bit, you can bow a little bit more broad. So we have had this. Make sure if you're going through this mezzo forte that starts in bar number 48, you have to do a little bit more bow, and also the spiccato is with the U, actually the bottom of the U is a little bit larger, and play the legato notes with a lot of confidence. So if I start in bar 48. So you don't want to do, but play it with, really bright and shining. Then count the notes in the end, so the long D count it very well, because it's three beats. And after that, we go back again to the forte, to the same theme we started with. We start now at the second half of bar number 56. And it's exactly the same as the beginning of the piece. So again. And after that we have eight measures of rest. And then a totally different atmosphere appears. It's mezzo forte, but it's tranquillo. So it's a different. Before this, it was very bright and cheerful, and now it's something very different and more in the lower range. And what you play here is a high third finger on the G string, so that's a C sharp. And you have that a couple of times, And then in bar number 58, we have an A sharp. It's actually not so difficult to play as it seems. So let's start at the mezzo forte again. Go very smoothly. Make sure the C sharp is high enough. Open D. Second finger. And leave your second finger there. Put your first finger, while you're playing this note, in bar number 87. Already place your first finger right behind that second finger. So when you go to bar number 88 and you have to play that A sharp, then you just have to lift your second finger. And then that second finger, while you're playing that A sharp, already goes to the F sharp in the bar after that. So we have. And then while you're playing that, place the first finger. And then while you're playing the first finger, your second finger is already there. So actually your fingers are working in advance. That's very nice if they do that, because then you can play it very fluent. And it's very important to play this part very fluently. But where you can prepare your fingers, really do this. Let's continue at bar 90. Do a fourth finger there and place your third finger right next to that fourth finger. So this was a whole different atmosphere suddenly in the middle of the piece. And after that, in bar 100, we go back again to this main theme. That's what happens in a rondo. So you have this same sentence a couple of times with different parts in between them. That's what a rondo actually is. Then let's go to bar number 100. Transition, a very quick transition to actually the same thing as we did in bar number 40. But you have to go there in one go from the forte. So this asks for some bow control. So let's start in bar number 109, the upbeat before 109. A little surprise there. Well, we know that from bar number 40, everything. Mind the bowing there, so keep a little eye on which eighth notes are with a slur and which aren't. Well, after that we find another familiar thing, and that's the mezzo forte we know from bar number 48. So we go right to the mezzo forte, just as we did in 48 when we also came from this piano. And you can really let that note sound there. You can play that open G string a little bit like there's a dot below it or something. Dum, bum. So we actually just had a compilation of several themes we have played throughout this piece. But now, and as a concertino is most of the times linked to each other, so the parts are not separate entities, but they're linked, we see something that we recognize a bit from the first part. That's the mezzo forte in bar number 133. What I also want you to do is to do a little accent on the first note of every eight, so on every first note of two bars. And I will show you what I mean by that. So this note, this, that one, that one, that one, that one, after that, this is still a little bit robot-like. So if you've done that, then make it more of a fluent sentence. And here we have, in bar number 147, we have the same rhythm as we had in the beginning of the piece. So, remember, but now we have it. But the bowing is the same. And then. And that's the end of the piece. Make sure to retake your bow so you're not playing something like that. Then the first of the two double stops, they're not very hard double stops, is with an open A string and a first finger on the E. And then you put that first finger on the A string and you put your low second finger on the E for the last one. So that's how that works. Well, you might want to study this part first very slowly, so I recommend starting with the tempo like this. One. Something like that, and then try to get it all very neat in that tempo, and if you manage to do that, then make it a little bit quicker, so something like that. So for the tempo overall in this Kugler tutorial, of course I'm talking in between and playing and that kind of stuff. So my tempo might change all the time because I am explaining different things in between. But try also to practice with metronome, but only do it when you already know the notes and you know how it goes, etc. etc. So don't start practicing with the metronome too early, but do it in if you kind of have the piece solid and you just want to make that rhythm a little bit neater. But of course, as you probably noticed what I do, I sometimes make a comma or sometimes slow down a bit or speed up a bit. If it has a musical purpose, you can do that. But if it's just because you're not counting, then and not for aesthetical purposes, then of course you need to correct that. Well, I hope you have a lot of fun playing this piece, and I also hope that you get a chance perhaps to play together with the pianist.
Now again, Tom Play can be your pianist, and it's a very patient one because he plays the piece at any tempo you want and without complaining. He repeats everything you want to repeat as many times as you like. So really go to the link below, get that app, use my special coupon code to get this 14-day trial and 30% off. Now, congratulations, because you have learned your first concerto. Yay! Let me know in the comments how you are doing, if you have further questions, and maybe what you would like to learn in this course. Well, first I'm going to give you another scale and an etude, and then we're going to play the Reading Concerto Opus 35. So I hope to see you in those next lessons. If you want to stay my student, then make sure you subscribe to my channel, and of course, like this video. So I hope to see you next lesson. Bye bye.